So here we are again. Welcome back, everybody. Hope you had a good week, and let's get started. I titled this particular unit, Fail to Plan, Plan to Fail. And it's an old saying you've probably heard, if you fail to plan, you might as well plan to fail. And many investigators you will meet in your life will tell you that they don't need an investigative plan. There are also people who tell you you don't need to wear that seatbelt, and why are you putting a helmet on your kid when they ride a bicycle? And several other things that we kind of know from research, although they may be a pain in the butt, they make sense. And from research, I will tell you that people who do investigative plans have a better closing record. People who plan their investigations out understand what they need to do before they get started, do a much better job. So let's kind of recap where we've been and then talk about where we're going to go in our plan. So where has our little team been? Well, in week one, we met. And then in week two, we talked about the right mindset, right? And so you're all now have your business suits on and you're all in the right mindset to investigate in a very orderly and calm and professional way. And then we talked about the solid base for an investigation, the what. If you don't have an actual offense that you can label as an offense and show is an offense of some kind of law, regulation, crime, or rule, then you really don't have the basis for an investigation. So we know each other, we have the right mindset, and now we've discovered that we have an actual offense and we have to investigate. So now we're gonna, from there, start to form a plan. So the big thing with the plan is it gets us organized, okay? You need to understand the things you need. You're building an investigation. Think of it as building. Now think about if you were gonna build a house, right? Or you're a contractor, you're gonna build a house for somebody. And you hire, 10 laborers, because it takes that many, right, to build a house, a big house. And you've got the land all set, and you get out there, and you say, okay, guys, today's day one, we're going to start. And they're all on the clock, and you're paying them all, and time is of the essence, because you got to get this job done. And the first thing somebody asks is, hey, boss, do we have any lumber? Do we have any nails? Did you bring a hammer? And that is what doing an investigation without a plan looks like. You get all geared up and you start, you plan your day and you're going to do this investigation and you don't have any of the tools you need. And the tools are artifacts and evidence and witnesses that you're going to need, information you're going to need to build this particular investigation. And so with the plan, you are able to understand what you need and what you'll need to do to make it a successful organization. So this will help you cover all the bases and not have you show up to that job site without the lumber and the nails and the tools you need to get the job done. So again, to do that, we set a solid investigative plan and we write out our plan. And it seems like tedious work. And that is why investigators very early in their career and security managers who do investigations on a somewhat frequent basis, but not as a full-time job, often just skip this step because it seems tedious. Right? And in some ways it is, but not all work that you do that is fruitful is exciting. And would you rather have a good outcome and be able to present a very solid case to your decision makers and be proud of the work you did, or would you rather get it done quick, phone it in, and hope for the best? And I think you really want something that you can present later that looks good. And you need a roadmap to get where you're going, right? You wouldn't go on a long trip like an investigation and not have a roadmap with you. One of the big things that you will see, unfortunately, when you get to that first job is that your peers don't necessarily do it or they don't do it very well. And that can be discouraging. Now, some other plans that I've seen in my career, I've seen them come out on PowerPoint slides. And that's not too bad, actually, because at least they're writing out something. But you'll notice in this particular lecture, I will jump from PowerPoint slides to a Word document and scroll through it a little bit because these things can be kind of wordy. So PowerPoint slides aren't always your best. Letters, invoices, and bids are very common when it comes to private investigators. So you call up a private investigator because, you may be an HR manager, perhaps, and your security manager is not an investigator. It may be something having to do with the security manager, or you are a security manager and you don't have time because you have a small staff, you have other things going, you're going to go be on vacation, you need something investigated. And you call a private investigator and they will send you a letter or an invoice, a bid for the job, and say, you have asked us to investigate the theft of batteries from your stockroom, and we will do that. And we will do it for X number of dollars. And that is their investigative plan. It doesn't tell you really what they're going to do and, you know, what you're going to get for your money. It's just a letter or an invoice, right? So it's not a very good plan. I think some of the best ones that made me snicker were people who wrote these things out on bar napkins, you know, the back of an envelope, on a paper plate. You know, let's just do this, 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 and this, and then we got it, and they check it off. But most of the time, they do nothing. You will find corporate security investigators, for the most part, will do very little in investigative planning, and those are the ones who are much less successful than others. So I really think that you ought to consider some type of investigative plan. I'm going to give you an example of what I do and what others I know do, and they do it with different forms sometimes, and there's, you know, little tweaks to it. You can really lay it out any way you want. Some people like to do it in a graph or in a timeline. You know, use a program that's much like project management. But a Word document for me works fine, and it's how I build my cases. And so, you know, I want to show you how that can be done without having you resulting to bar napkins, invoices, and PowerPoint slides. So what does your plan entail? The plan lays out, remember we talked about the what, the when, the where, the how, the who, and the why of a matter? And I've been calling them cases because it's just something that rattles well off the tongue. We're all used to it, working an investigative case. In corporations, you really work matters. And it's just a nuance. I think cases just relates better to police work. A detective works a case, right? And in corporate investigators, oftentimes, because others in other compliance functions, safety people often work investigative matters, HR people work investigative matters, we tend to use that terminology. So I'm going to be very hard on myself and try to say matter rather than case. I will slip up. Try to get in the habit of calling them matters. And it also helps when you're interviewing somebody later on, you sit and you say, I'm working on a case. It tends to get them tense, where if I'm working on a matter, it's more of it's a softer word, right? It's all a nuance. But we know we have to have the what, the when, the where, the how, the who, and the why, right? And the why, maybe. But what we're going to do in our plan is we're going to identify each one of those things and what we need to know about each one of those things to prove our case, right? To know that we've thoroughly investigated the matter. We may not come up with a subject or a suspect. We may go through the investigation and it may dead end on us. But if we know what we need to do to prove, we have our what, the when, the where, the how, the who, then we know that we have done everything we can do. You'll know when you hit the goal of each one of those things. I've completed that section. I know that I'm confident in the where. I know that I'm confident in the when. When you lay out what you have to prove and then go ahead and check it off. And also in some investigations, your boss, your client, whoever you may be working for, may want to know, you know, what are you going to do about this? And running a full investigative plan in front of them might be very helpful for you to explain that to them, and it gives them the confidence they need in you and your ability. So an investigative plan in practice, it has the what, and last week we spent a fair amount of time writing out the what because it's just the basis for everything, right? We're going to have sections in our plan that also lay out the when. That's the initial time frame of the matter, what we know from jump. When it's reported, we have an idea of an initial time frame. And that's what we're basing it on. Now, as the investigation goes on, that may change, right? We may find new information that says, wait a minute, that didn't happen then. It happened way long ago. That's okay. We're going to talk about the initial plan. We're going to have initial information. We're going to have an initial location affected, right? Where did this happen? We're going to have some general statements about how it may have happened. How could this have occurred, right? If it's a theft, how could it have occurred? If it was behind a locked door, whatever the item was it left out in the open? You know, how might someone have taken this and gotten away with it? Just initially. Again, initially, who might we want to talk to about this? Who could some witnesses be? This is normally by classification rather than by name. You know, if there was an assault on a company trip and it was on a bus, the initial witness list would be, well, who's on the bus, right? We don't have to list the people right away. We might say, okay, we want to talk to the people who are on the bus. And then we want to narrow it down to those who were in the front or the back, depending on where the incident took place, right? And then the why that we really don't have to prove as part of our case, but there could be some obvious reasons the person might have perpetrated the offense, and there could be some that are not so obvious. And it may change your whole focus of the who and who you want to talk to. You know, in the incident that I mentioned about the defibrillators having a lithium battery, you know, once I found that out, then I started to turn to, okay, who that had access may also want to have large amounts of lithium. Let's look for people who might have signs of a substance abuse problem or the types of indicators that show that they may be involved in the meth trade, right? You know, those types of things make a difference. So the why can help you investigate. It's not something you have to prove, but it is something that may give you some clues. So our investigative plan is going to lay out the what, the when, the where, the how, the who, and the why, initially what we know, and from that we'll build again. So let's just take a quick look at what one might look like. Okay, so here on the screen, hopefully you see a basic investigative plan, and it has some basic header information like anything should, right? The investigator, the date opened, the complainant's name and contact information, and then a date closed or suspended on the particular matter. If it dead ends, it's suspended. If it's solved, it's closed. It's really just basic. I don't have a case number. I know some people put case numbers on these. The system that I put these in, actually, I used a system called Team Connect, but there are lots and lots of them out there. Again, IRAMS is a nice one. D3 is a decent one. Basically, once you put information in for the first time, it will generate a case number. And so when you're doing your plan first, in order to put in there to start one, you don't have the case number first. So, you know, it doesn't necessarily need to be there. But what we have here is the basic information, and then we have our what. And this may look familiar to you. Mr. Jones, the stockroom manager, reported that 5 cases of 9-volt batteries were missing from the stockroom. Same Mr. Jones, same stockroom, same 5 cases of batteries at a value of $1,500. And we put in our what, right? We know that theft of company property is covered in the handbook, and we say where it is on page 42, and that the person may be terminated, and it's also a crime, which leaves, again, us the option. If we find this person is responsible for this theft, and we may be able to tag them to other thefts, we may want to open up prosecution, or even open up prosecution on this one for some one reason or another. So we put in there that we know it's a criminal offense to remind us and remind others that that is an option. So if we go here to this case and we go down, now we list our when. So here's our when. Mr. Jones reported the matter on 7/9 of 2020. And he related the batteries were discovered missing on 9/5/2020. Now, when you think about that when, you could say, okay, well, then the batteries were taken before the 5th, but we really don't know exactly when. What we need to do to support this investigation is we need to show the last time the batteries were accounted for. So if we know that they were discovered missing on the 5th, we have no idea that they may have been taken a year, 2 years, 3 years ago. When was the last time anybody accounted for those batteries? So that is one thing we need to support the investigation and to find our when is it is sometime before the 5th, but we need to find out how soon that could be. So we need to know the last time the batteries were accounted for. Makes sense, right? If something is missing, you say, when was it last seen? We know when it's missing. We discovered it at such and such a time and date, but when would you last see it? And that gives us our time frame, right? Start and stop times. But we also need to know the exact time they were thought to be missing, the discovery time. And the reason I say that is they were discovered missing on 9/5. Well, Mr. Jones may not have been the person who actually said, hey, the batteries are missing. He's the stockroom manager. Thinking ahead, did a stockroom worker find them missing? And did that worker discover them on the 2nd, but said, ah, Mr. Jones must have moved the batteries. I'll have to ask him about that. And then they went to Mr. Jones on the 5th and said, hey, Mr. Jones, you know, those 5 cases of batteries, where'd you put those? He says, well, I put them in the rack where they always belong. And the guy says, well, they're not there. Oh, they've been stolen again. We got a thief of batteries. And then he comes in and reports them missing on that time and date, when actually the time and date of exact discovery was when that first worker found that they were missing. So you need to understand what the exact discovery time was, when they were thought to be missing. You want to narrow the time frame. So these are questions and things you need to find out. And then you need to understand whether all of them were found missing at one time or whether this could have been a single instance or multiple instances of theft. So if Mr. Jones says, I'm missing five cases of batteries, and he says it was discovered on the 5th, well, that's when he determined it was a theft, because the first two cases that went missing last month, he didn't think too much of. He figured he just made an accounting error. Then when three more came up missing this month. So you need to ask that question. So it's something you need to understand. Were all of these there at one point and then all of them missing at the same time, or did it happen? So basically, you're asking certain things about the when, and those are things in this case that you need to support your when. So they're going to be pretty consistent. The last time something was accounted for, seen, the time that it was reported, if it's a violent crime perhaps, and then, you know, when did it first occur? You want to try to narrow your time frame. So you're going to have things that you need to understand so you can find your when. Same thing goes for the where, right? He reported the batteries were missing from the stock room in rack 9, aisle B, right? It's a big stock room, a big warehouse type thing, right? That's where they were. To support the investigations, you have to show that the batteries were actually there. So they were placed in that reported location. And that other possible locations were checked. So if you go and you say, okay, they were taken out of, was it aisle, let me scroll here, rack 9, aisle B. And you go and you start to investigate and you say, Mr. Jones, show me where that is. And you look and you say, well, you couldn't fit five cases of batteries in there. Oh, well, you know, that's where we store them when we can. And if we have leftovers, we put them over here on, you know, aisle C. You need to look for other possible locations. In some cases, you will recover the alleged stolen item. In others, you will find that they were also taken from another location. So what you're doing is you're thinking about things you need to prove to show that you have the exact where or the exact when. And it goes for how and who. Okay, you all have a copy of this. The why, really, in this particular case, I asked that same question that we just brought up in the, you know, in the discussion. You know, are these regular 9-volt batteries or are they lithium batteries? What's another use? You know, the why could be that somebody wanted them for the drug trade as opposed for the fact that they wanted to steal batteries to use in their kids' toys, right? And so, you know, there may be more whys to it. So things that you may need to support the investigation. So basically, it is ways that you're going to narrow things down. And for your where and your when, these are pretty basic questions. I think that you can modify slightly in another scenario to show that you have narrowed down and can absolutely prove you have the right where and the right when in any matter. So what do we gain by this plan? Well, it keeps us very focused. We can go from each one of those elements of an investigation, from the what that we've defined to the when, the where, the who, the how, the why, and we can go through in each step and tick off the boxes to make sure we get everything covered, all the information we need, so that our case is solid. Now, if we find new information, as you find a new where, right? Let's go back to our, well, we don't always store all the batteries there. Sometimes if we don't have enough room, we put them over in aisle C. Well, now you need to understand a potential when of aisle C. You know, is aisle C someplace people can get to, whereas aisle B is locked up at night? You know, could be different whens, right? Now you might have a multi-stage theft. So the new information gets added to your plan as you go along, as you find new information. Okay, so you might have to go out and find more artifacts, bring in more lumber and nails of different types as you find that you might need them. Okay. This investigative plan makes a really nice basis for an eventual investigative report, and we'll talk about that next week, and you'll see how this converts nicely to an investigative report. And for those of you who use tools like OneNote, and there are many, many others out there, you know, it's basically an organization, document organization type setup, much like a notebook, you can take this basic plan and then have tabs for your when, your where, your how, your why, and build into those tabs really nicely. And so if you don't have a case reporting tool, and many of you will not, if you don't work for a very big organization, you'll be a security manager who's expected to work with pen and paper, right? Microsoft Word, anything that's in the Office suite, OneNote makes a really good setup for that. So if you happen to be good at OneNote, you'll be able to keep yourself organized putting the plan there. But that's what you gain. You really gain focus and organization, and those are critical to a good investigation. So we built our plan, right? And you saw how we took our when, and we asked ourselves, you know, what do we need to do to prove our when? And we put those proofs in there. Now we take that information, and it helps us determine what artifacts, witnesses, and information we might need, at least at first, to get to those proofs. So we're going to start to build on it. So I'm taking the when from this case, right? Mr. Jones reported the matter on 9-7. He relayed the battery to discovery missing on 9-5. And we had three things we needed to show or understand to put this to bed, right? To have our when. So the first one was to show the last time the batteries were accounted for. Well, in order to do that, we need first proof they were ever received. We need proof of the last inventory and the results. And then proof that of any activity, right? Did other people come into the stock room and legitimately sign out a case of batteries, or half a case, or three, or two batteries, right? We have to look and to make sure the things were accounted for. The proofs we need are receipt, last inventory, the last time they were checked on, and we know we have the right number, and then any activity since then that may have thrown that number off. We want to be able to show the exact time the batteries were thought to be missing. We want to know the discovery time. Well, we need verification of the last sighting. Mr. Jones telling us it was reported, you know, they've been missing since the 5th, doesn't tell us much if somebody else actually saw that and reported it to him. When did someone go and say, hey, these things aren't here, they're missing? Oftentimes that is much earlier than the reported time because people tend to do their own investigation first, which is actually pretty prudent to do. Especially on a theft, right? No harm, no foul. If something's missing, you go and you start looking around for it first to make sure that you don't report something that's not really missing, it's just misplaced. But you need verification of the last sighting, and then first verification of the discovery of alleged theft, right? So last time I saw it, I know when we locked up Friday, I checked and I said, okay, we're good on batteries. I don't need to stock any of those on Monday because there were five cases there, and I locked the cabinet. And the first discovery of the alleged theft, the cabinet was already unlocked when I got here. So I went back and I went to go check some out, and they were all gone. And I checked the ledger and nobody signed them out. Those are your last sighting and your first discovery, right? So those are two things you're going to need, some verification. So now you know that you need to go look for that verification. You know, on the first one, you need to have the proof that they were received, right? In order to show that they were accounted for, that you actually had them there. So to understand whether the batteries were found missing at one time or maybe a multiple instance of theft, when you look at the time frames, was there sufficient time to support a face theft? If your time frame is they were stolen sometime between the 1st of August and the last of October, you have sufficient time frame to have multiple thefts and have one big loss. So I went looking one time for missing Lipitor. Lipitor is a drug people take for high cholesterol. And we were manufacturing it in 1,600 count bottles, because those bottles would then be broken up by a pharmacist to put into your prescription bottles or your parents' prescription bottles. And so they would order a 1,600 count bottle. A 1,600 count bottle had a value of about $9,500 at the time. And I went on a theft of five of them. It was reported as a theft of five. And I found out that, indeed, this was five over a five-month period. And in the course of the investigation, did discover, along with who the subject was that was stealing them, that they were indeed taking one per month because they had a rogue pharmacy in their neighborhood that would buy them on the black market from them. But they only needed one per month. They couldn't afford to buy them all up front. So, you know, understanding that time frame may make you have pause to say, maybe I need to prove this was just one theft, rather than somebody going in and taking a few out at a time and it, you know, happened over a long period of time. So we've taken our when, we've taken the basic proofs that we need to show, the things we need to show. Now we're talking about what can we do to show that? What proofs do we need? What stuff do we need to start looking at to do this? The same is true with the where. So Mr. Jones reported the batteries are missing from that rack in that aisle. Well, we need to know who stacked the five cases in the rack. And did they do all five? Right? Where might we find that out? Well, that looks like an interview to me, to the person. If it's not Mr. Jones, who stocked it in there? And where did they get the five cases from? Did they bring all five over at the same time? And did all five go into that rack? Okay. You know, were there already some in the rack? So you know you stocked five cases in there, but you know, were there already some in there? Was it completely empty? Or just stack some on top? We need to know exactly, you know, where this occurred and how many, right? We need to know our total. So is it a concealed shortage? A concealed shortage would be, you know, you had five cases. So five cases could be stacked, you know, three in the front or two in the front and three in the back. And when you move the two in the front, you find out there's a big hole in the back. That's a concealed shortage. Somebody stole one and left a void in there and you couldn't really see it until you started moving things around. So you need to understand, you know, who placed them in the rack and did they place them all at the same time? Show that all possible locations for storage were checked for the missing batteries. When they stocked, did they all fit? Did some get staged someplace else, and has that been checked? That, again, to me, sounds like an interview question. So, in order to prove our where, we should be thinking about the fact that we need to interview some people, right? Because these are the questions, in order to have our proofs, these are the questions we need answered. And those are only questions that can come from a person. We can't get documents to answer necessarily those, that we need to talk to people for our where. So now we're back to our investigative plan. It's the original one we started with, right? Same one. But what you notice is when I got to the when, before it just had the show the last known time the batteries were accounted for, show the exact time the batteries were thought to be missing, understand where all the batteries were found, if they were found missing at one time or whether it could have been a, you know, multiple occurrence theft, right? Or single theft. But what I did was I took the first one and I broke it down. So I said, look, we need proof when they were received, right? We needed proof of the last inventory and the results. We needed proof of any activity or removal as part of the normal process. Where are we going to get those? So now we make a list from the list. We're breaking it down farther. One of the artifacts I need in this matter is a shipper or a signed receipt of goods. If I want to prove my when, right, I need to show the last time the batteries were accounted for. And as part of that, I need to prove that they were even received. And in order to do that, I need to see a shipper. A shipper is something that comes in, you know, when you order of something and they deliver it, they give you that piece of paper with it, that receipt for it, that's called a shipper. Or a bill of lading in some places if it's a big order, but shipper is normally the term used. If I see a shipper that said, we got in five cases of batteries, I know that they were there in the first place. That last inventory and the results are one way I'm going to show when they were accounted for. So there ought to be an inventory control log or a daily count sheet, something that Mr. Jones and his team go through and every once in a while and check to see how many batteries they actually have. If they don't do that, how do I know five even disappeared? How did they know they even had five there, other than the fact that we thought we put five there and sure enough, they're not there anymore? I need some form of proof in order to prove my when. And I need that inventory control log to tell me when they last saw them, when they actually did a physical count, and when that physical count was done and they didn't find the ones they needed. And then I need to know any regular signouts, right? So if they did an inventory control log on the 4th and they had five cases present, I need to go through and find out if anybody signed out one or two cases or even all five. Then I would solve my matter right there, right? It would be done. But I need proof of activity. So for my when, in order to determine it, I need to know certain things. I need to show certain things. And in order to show that, I need proof of certain things. And the way I'm going to get that proof is a certain artifact or document or piece of information. Pretty basic stuff, but you're making a list from a list. If you start with the right statements here, then these become even more intuitive. And the last one becomes pretty intuitive, quite frankly. If you need to prove they were ever received, well, a receipt is what shows something was received, right? If you need proof of the last inventory and the results, there's got to be a document somewhere that shows that. If you needed activity removal, well, there's a sign-out process in every stockroom to show you took something. And if you don't have that, you're never going to solve this matter anyway. You wouldn't spend a lot of time investigating it because they have poor controls in place. So you're building a list from lists. Making this list from a list, I know this is a difficult topic, and I fully expect a lot of questions this week. And in fact, I welcome them. Very hard to teach this part, you know, the investigative plan, in an online environment. I will admit that, but it can be done, but we may need to communicate some. But basically what you're doing is you're starting with your plan, description of what was reported and what you need to prove, your when, your where, your why, your how, your who, right? Basically what you need to prove, right? I need to prove that these batteries were stolen, and I need to prove that they were stolen from the stockroom, and I need to prove they were stolen between this time. And from that, then you build down. Well, What do I need to what do I need in my hand to prove those things? What artifacts do I need? What evidence do I need to collect? What interviews might I need to do to prove these things? The investigative plan is very important in that regard, because if you just go out nilly-willy and start investigating people, you're going to find that stories change, that people will talk to other people, that they will remind them of things that they don't have any memory of to start with. So when you ask, well, did you see Mr. Jones count those batteries? Oh, yeah, I definitely. He counted them on Friday. Then you find out the person wasn't even at work on Friday, and you say, well, you told me you saw him count them on Friday, but you weren't here. Oh, yeah, but Joe saw him. Joe told me he saw it. There's a big difference in that. We will spend an entire week talking about eyewitnesses very soon, and you will be surprised how poor that evidence is. So making the list from the list and knowing who you're going to talk to ahead of time before you go out and nilly-willy start pulling pieces of investigation, then going back and getting it, you look much more organized, you are much more organized, and your investigation will go much smoother, and you will get better information if you have your plan up front. That's the big thing, is knowing what you're going to need. You're making your shopping list, if you will, for your investigation by asking the questions about what you're going to need and what you're going to prove. So now we have our list of artifacts and information we need to investigate our matter, right? If we go through each one of those sections, as we did for our when, and make a list of the documents or the people or what we're going to need to show that the thing happened and it happened when we thought, and now get down to who did it, right? We know up front. And one of the reasons you want to know up front is that artifacts may take time. Remember when we talked in week two, the police can get information, boom, like that, right? They can go online and they can pull up anybody's criminal history. Well, it may take me a week or more to get a criminal history back on someone, an accurate one. I may need to contract it with somebody, use a service that's a little slower. If I know up front I have to get that, I may want to wait to investigate or at least interview someone till I get that back. But without a plan, if I know I want to interview somebody, I decide, oh yeah, he could be a witness, call him in. I might not find out till a week later that the guy was fired from his last, two jobs for theft. And that would definitely make an impact on my investigation, and it would definitely have shown that I wasted my time interviewing because he wasn't going to offer that up probably, right? If I know what I need up front, I can understand how long it may take me to get that stuff, and I can get all of my ducks in a row beforehand. Okay? It also helps with our time needs and our resource needs. So when you compile that list, that to-do list, make that correction right now, you understand whether it's worth investigating in the first place. Right? When you find out that you have 5 cases of missing batteries, and in the end, because of what you've compiled in your plan, there were 250 people who had access to that storeroom. And there was open access to those batteries during the entire time, and you have no cameras or anything that would show people carrying cases of batteries out, I would not spend an awful lot of time and resources on this investigation. Sure, it's $1,500 loss, and that is a loss, but I would more like to spend my time with Mr. Jones talking about locks and keys, and putting batteries behind the counter. Think about the drugstores that put the Sudafed and the razor blades behind the counter because they get stolen a lot. I would rather spend my time on prevention in this case rather than investigation. And your investigative plan, if it gets too complex, you're able to do a gut check and go back and say, gosh, I've got to gather up 100 documents and talk to 100 people over the theft of $100. This is not a fruitful investigation. And that's another big thing that your plan will do. You'll be able to do a gut check and say, okay, I've got to do these things. Is it worth? Is the juice worth the squeeze? Right? Should I be doing this investigation in the first place? So the plan helps with all of those things. So we have to put this into practice, right? We've got to have a way for you to see if you can do this on your own. And again, it is not easy. It's like taking baby steps. It really is. Some of you, it may come much easier than I think. But for most people, when I've taught this in the past, it is something that's just not as intuitive until you've done it a few times. I'm going to give you my basic investigation plan in a blank form, and I'm going to give you a scenario. I'm going to give you the what. Then I want you to populate the when, the where, the how, the who, and the why sections with basic things that you would do to support the investigation. So the first thing is, you know, what are those things you need to show? To support this investigation, I need to show what, right? And you will follow much of what we used in the example, and there'll be the example one that is in a lecture. I will also post that, so you can use that as kind of a template, right? Some of those basic things you need to prove: a when, a where, a how, a who, right? Then I want you to go back to that when section and take it down the next two levels. So in order to prove the when, I need to understand, you know, the initial discovery time. That's something that, you know, the exact discovery time. That's very important in any time something is reported. Exactly when did this happen? Well, you know, we were all downtown and it was late and, you know, so-and-so did this to this person. Doesn't help me any. When was it? Let's start to narrow down that when. So what can I do to narrow down the when? I mean, I need to talk to more people. I may need to understand whether the place that this transpired was accessible, right? You know, it was lunchtime in the cafeteria when so-and-so took a swing at so-and-so. Okay, when is lunchtime? I need the hours for the cafeteria, if it was lunchtime, right? Cafeterias sometimes open at 11:30, sometimes close at 2 o'clock in a big manufacturing site. Some of them close at 1 o'clock. I don't know the hours for the cafeteria exactly. On that day, was it open in the normal hours? So you'll need to drill those down. And then understand, you know, you may need to talk to the cafeteria manager for that particular scenario, right? So I want you to drill down, just like in the lecture, I want you to start to list the items that you need to show. Then how can you prove that? And then what artifacts would you necessarily need, or interviews or those things would you need to prove that? And you'll do that as part of your discussion assignment. So what you'll be submitting in the discussion forum will be a basic investigative plan with the one section expanded. The other sections don't need to be expanded, just that one section. Then in responses, you'll do two responses. You're going to look at other people's plans, and they will be different than yours. They will have different proofs. I want you to think about what they put in there and make a comment as to whether you think what they put in there is even necessary, or if what you were looking for is better, or if you might say, you know what, that's a great piece of information. I want to add that to my plan. And then go back and add it to your plan, because we're going to use these plans again. The initial is due on Thursday at 5 p.m., and the responses are due Sunday at 11:59, just as in future and past ones. I don't think there are any this term that are different on those due dates, and if there are, I will let you know way ahead of time. But that's what you're going to do, an initial plan with just the basics and one section expanded as we did in the lecture. Is this harder than other assignments? I think it is, because it's one of the things that's not so intuitive about investigations, because so few people do investigative plans and they just don't understand the value in them. It's an outline for what you're going to do and what you're going to prove. But you should have questions. I would be very surprised if no one in this course had questions about this assignment. And I don't get a lot of questions out of this group because, frankly, this course is mostly upperclassmen, and you've been down the road, right? You have some basic knowledge. And so, you know, it's not like a beginning class by any stretch. But you should have questions. We can Zoom, write, text. If someone asks a question and it's a question that will relate to everybody else, I want you to watch the news section of this course. I put a lot of stuff in the news section. I try to get in there at least 2-3 times a week, put stuff in there. If questions come up about this discussion and this assignment, I will post them there. I won't say who asked the question. I'll just say a student asked a question concerning this. This is what you need to know so that everybody gets the same answers. All right? Make sure you're checking that frequently. Don't wait till Thursday when it's due and check that, because it may change your whole attitude about the assignment, right? But if you don't ask, I can't help you. So please understand that I know this is a bit of a difficult assignment for some. And if you're going to have any trouble with it, that's okay. I'm going to be pretty easy on the grading so long as you try it. But I want you to put your best effort forward. And if you have questions, please let me know. More than happy to talk to you. You know, our weeks are all busy. Many of us are, you know, in the class, even are working jobs and then coming to go to school. I work a full-time job during the day. However, I have time during the day where I can certainly take phone calls. I can tailor it weekends, nights. It doesn't matter. But I can't help you if you don't ask. So let's make sure that if you have questions, you bring them forward. But the most important thing is that everybody has a great week. I look forward to hearing from you. on the assignment. Look forward to the stuff you submit. So far, the work in this course has just been outstanding. I think everybody is really doing a top-notch job on this. And next week, we'll be starting to talk about the investigative report, and we'll be talking about interviewing soon. That's some exciting stuff, so I look forward to that, and I will see you on campus.